Namaskaram. I'm Pradeep Chakravarti and I'm really happy to do this with Kala Kendra for Navratri 2020. Let's take a step back to understand why we're doing this. All living things want to be happy, whether they are higher order animals like us or lower order animals. Now, what causes us to be happy, both in the short term and long term? Three things are important. First is wisdom. So the wisdom to know what is happy, what is not happiness, what can give us happiness, what cannot give us happiness, long term, short term, all of this is one. The second is wealth. Wealth need not be just money, it could be health also, number two. So wisdom, then wealth. The third will be courage. The courage to think and act in a particular way so that we become happy and it is in the long term. Maybe because wealth, wisdom and courage was so important for happiness, they gave goddesses to look after these things, and that is what Navratri really celebrates. So let me invite you on this journey of listening to the stories of 9 women from Indian history, some of them fairly famous, some of them not so famous, but all of them role models who embodied wealth, wisdom and courage in some way or the other, and therefore have earned a place in Indian history as great role models for us to follow. So our hope is that you listen to these short stories of these women, maybe you read up a little bit more about them, but most important, you have a dialogue with other people at home during this festive occasion to see what we can learn from these women for our own lives. So thank you very much, and I invite you on this journey of 9 days, 9 women, for Navratri 2020. Namaskaram. Today is day 5 of Navratri, continuing our stories of inspiring Indian women from Indian history. Today's story is on Soundaram Ramachandran. Soundaram was born in 1904 and she passed away in 1984. She was a member of the Legislative Assembly, she was Deputy Minister for Education, and in fact it was at that time that compulsory free primary education was introduced, and she played an important role in the NSS movement in India. But she is really remembered for her excellent work in Gandhigram University, which is one of the finest in India, if not in Asia, in the work that it does for empowering children and women. Soundaram was born as a daughter to a very well-known industrialist, and as was in those days the case, she was married when she was about 8 years old. She was married to her own uncle, Dr. Soundararajan, and they had a happy life until, unfortunately, when she was 14 or 15 years old, Dr. Soundararajan at that point of time was treating a lot of patients of bubonic plague, and he himself succumbed to the disease. And it is said at that point of time when he was in his dying bed, Soundaram, who must have been only 14 or 15 years old, was so distraught that she even contemplated on committing suicide. Then her father, T.V. Sundaram Iyengar, and her mother, Lakshmi, and of course her dying husband, they prevailed upon her. And those days, the life for a widow was very difficult, and especially for a young widow. And in most cases, they would just rot away in their life. But fortunately for her and for her parents, she was encouraged to study. And they took this very radical step of sending her to Lady Hardinge College in Delhi, far away Delhi, because they were in Madurai at that time, sending her to Delhi. And to stay in a hostel for a single woman to do that must have been a very, very path-breaking act at that point of time. She, of course, studied extremely well, qualified herself. And at that point of time in Delhi, she must have come into connection with Gandhiji and with Tagore, and she threw herself completely into the freedom movement, which is also where she met Ramachandran, and they got married at a later point of time as well. So when at that point of time, Gandhiji seems to have influenced her to go back to the South and do something in Madras Presidency, which was what Tamil Nadu was. And she came back and she worked with Dr. Muthulakshmi Reddy, again a great trailblazing woman that we need to know much more about. They both started the Kasturbai Sevika Ashram, which was really for destitute women and for widows, because they were really vulnerable in society, deserted women or widows at that point of time. And then I think Gandhiji prevailed upon her to say that, well, what you've done is good, but why don't you go further down south in Tamil Nadu to where you come from, which is the Madurai region, and see if you can do something over there. So she went further down south, and a friend of her brother's gave her some 23 acres of land with good quality water, and that's where she started what is today Gandhigram University. In October 7th, 1947, she started a small clinic, a Balwadi, which in those days was unheard of because you don't have orphanages like you have today. And it was called the Kasturbai Sevika Ashram. And this was for widows and destitute and for the very, very poor women. This institute still survives. Of course, destitute women and widows are not that many as they were before, precisely because of the wonderful work done by people like her. Today, there are more than 185 children, girl children, who study in that school. And the rest of her life was spent in bringing funding into this institution, talking about it to people, and starting new projects within. And everything would start with an actual, very basic need. Story has it that one day when she was getting into a car and she was just going to start the car, she heard the voice of an infant. And she was horrified to find there was a little child under her car. And immediately she started an orphanage at that point of time for children, and that's grown into a children's home today in Gandhigram. Then as children started getting older, schools became important. So she started a school, and then an institute became important in terms of education after school, and that eventually became Gandhigram University today, which was inaugurated by the then Prime Minister. This was not enough. When she found out that it was important for women in the villages to have some kind of an occupation, not just for the income, but for their own self-esteem, she started a whole list of products that they could manage. Khadi was extremely important because she was a Gandhian. So khadi was manufactured, soaps and shampoos were made, and she was very passionate about native medicine. So she started an organization for women and villagers to make Siddha and Ayurvedic medicine as well. So that in that way, not only did they get an employment opportunity, she was also bringing that Indian spirit and Indian identity into the people at the village as well. Those people who remember Soundaram today remember her for a phenomenal sense of perseverance and commitment to her cause. She would never hesitate, never flinch in asking for money because she was fully convinced that it went to the right cause of helping women and children. And something that many people in Gandhigram who worked with her personally constantly told me was, much more than talking about what we should be doing, she would actually do it. So the one thing that she seemed to have done extremely well, and which is why she's inspired so many people, is that she constantly did as she spoke, and she taught others to do things by the way she did them herself. So these are a few things about Soundaram that we need to remember today. I would strongly encourage you to go and find out more about her and the excellent work that Gandhigram still does, and see what are some inspiring values that you can learn from her and how you can practice it during and after Navaratri 2020. Thank you very much.